alhamdulillah, our session, our course, it is kind of academic study that we need to study usul al-tafsir, the fundamentals of tafsir, the methodology of the tafsir. And when it comes to that course, the academic course, we rely on many sources when it comes to the tafsir of the Quran. And of course, it is something we need to understand and we need to realize when it comes to the types of tafsir that we have mentioned. But let me just remind you how we started that session. We started by explaining the word tafsir and the difference between the mufassir and mujtahid. Then we gave the tafsir, the explanation for the conditions of the tafsir and the conditions that are required for the mufassir to have. So anyone wanted to give the tafsir, he has to meet certain requirements, like having the correct belief, having the correct aqidah, having the correct methodology, having the correct knowledge to know more about the Islamic Sharia branches, like fiqh, like tawheed, like seerah. So he has to have the comprehensive knowledge of the language itself. He cannot explain the Quran without being fluent, without being fully acquainted to the Arabic language, and to be professional in the Arabic language, how to judge for the verb, how to differentiate between the verb and the noun, how to know why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used these prepositions and he did not use the other one. And then we move to the other section, which is the types of tafsir. And we give two major types of tafsir. I'm not quizzing you tonight, but just I wanted to refresh your minds. We mentioned that we have two types of tafsir. The first one is tafsir al-ma'thur, or sometimes you will find it in other books, tafsir bil-athar. Tafsir al-ma'thur, that means the tafsir was transmitted to us. And we have four types under this category. Then we have the other branch or the other type for the tafsir, which is tafsirun bil-ra'yi. Someone is giving his own opinion based on his rational, independent thinking. So that is what we call it, tafsirun bil-ra'yi. And still we are explaining in the first section, and we have the four types. We explained tafsir al-Qur'ani bil-Qur'an, how the Quran explained itself in certain areas in the Quran, and we give it many examples for that, such as we have very concise definition for a certain term. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in another verse, in another chapter, He is giving the details about that term. Sometimes Allah defines something. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give a certain rule, but even without telling the wisdom at the same verse, at the same context. In another surah, Allah explains in details what is the wisdom behind that rule. Just trying to refresh our minds. And number two, we explain the other type of tafsir, which is tafsir al-Qur'ani bis-sunnah. So the hadith, the statements of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to clarify and to elaborate some of the unclear verses during his time. And be aware, that was the time of the Sahaba. And we give many examples for the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and how he reflected, how he answered some of the questions for some people used to come to ask him about the Quran itself. Then we are moving tonight, inshallah, to the third type, which is tafsir al-sahaba, or the tafsir of the Quran by using the opinions of the sahaba. And I will tell you why we rely upon that kind of tafsir, and what is the importance of that type of tafsir. It is something we have to know. It is something we have to realize when it comes to the Sahaba. And why we chose the Sahaba, as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in the authentic hadith, And it is mentioned in al-Bukhari and Muslim when sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, khayrul quruni qarni, the best generation ever is my generation. Then he said, thumma alladhina yalunahum, then those people who will come after, thumma alladhina yalunahum, then those people who will come after them. Then he said, thumma al-amthal fal-amthal fal-amthal, means then those people who will follow their footsteps, those people who will follow their direction, they will be the best in my ummah. And let me tell you one of our doctrine. Who is the best man ever? Rasulullah, that's our belief, that's our doctrine. This is our aqeedah. And let's say, who are the best of the creation of Allah? The prophets and the messengers of Allah. And then rank number two, who are in the second degree the best people after the prophets and the messengers? The Sahaba, the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you could ask yourself, why exactly the Sahaba? Because we have Sahaba for Jesus, Sahaba for Moses, Sahaba for Ibrahim, Sahaba for Noah, you know? Because they are the best people, supported their prophet. They followed him to the degree that they imitated him in each and everything. They imitated almost his entire life. So they believe, and not only this, they followed his sunnah, they studied, and they transmitted his knowledge and his message. They conveyed the message to others, not only believe and practiced by their own selves, but also they taught other, they transmitted to other, they conveyed the message. That is why they deserved to get that title, the best generation ever after the prophets and the messengers of Allah. And now, just I'm asking you, why we should stick with the tafsir of the Sahaba? Why we should rely and depend on the tafsir, the explanation of the companions of the Prophet to the Quran? Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That's a great point. Actually, I tried to summarize it to make it so short. As Dr. Yusuf said, don't talk too much. That's why I obey. So you notice that. So we try to summarize it and to make it short. That's why I have three reasons. We have more than this, but the basic reasons, the main reasons are these three. We rely on the Sahaba because of, number one, they have the dignity, the honor of the companionship of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They saw him, they met him, they sat with him, they sat with him, and they listened to him. They asked him. Whenever they have something confused them, they used to ask the Prophet Muhammad. They have this companionship to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is what we call it, sharafus suhba, the dignity, the honor, the pleasure of being a companion to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is number two? They had something, I summarized it in one word to memorize it. It is called, they have the honor of an-naql. An-naql, that's the Arabic term. What is the meaning of an-naql? An-naql, as I told you, this course is a little bit academic course, okay? That's why it's different. So don't get mad at me if you are listening to something academic somehow, okay? But we agreed upon and you agreed, okay? So academic, that means we need to learn more about these terms and memorize it. So what is the meaning of a naql? A naql, that means to transmit something, the transmission, the chain of the transmission. A naql is, the word naql comes from, you have the naql wal muwasalat. So you have the transportation, that's what we call it, a naql. Okay, a naql al jama'i, the collective one. Like you have a bus, you have train, you have something that is called naql. So to transfer something, it is called naql linguistically. But according to the Sharia, it means to transmit certain information. So the Sahaba have the advantage of a naql. And a naql has two types. Naql, ru'ya, ru'ya. They saw something and they transmitted. Or sama'i. Yes, by hearing. They heard something from Rasulullah, then they transmitted. That is why they have this advantage. And their ahadith can be marfu'. Ahadith can be marfu'. What's the meaning of marfu'? Marfu', that is directly to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So sometimes you have that hadith, which is one narrator who have heard from Rasulullah by himself. Then he says, عن أبي هريرة عن رسول الله. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrated by himself, and he have heard by himself from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that is something very important and very authentic. So they have this advantage. The generation who came after the Sahaba, they don't have this. They did not see Rasulullah. They did not see the occasions, the incidents happened in front of Rasulullah. And they did not watch Rasulullah, how he behaved. And they did not hear directly from Rasulullah. That is why the generation of the Sahaba has this advantage. What is number two? They are Arab khullas. Arab khullas. Do you mean the word khullas? Khullas, what the meaning of word khullas? Pure. Perfect, mashallah. Khullas, that means they are pure Arabs. And notice, during that time, you did not have lots of Muslims who entered Islam from the non-Arabs. So they have the advantage of understanding the Arabic language, and they can explain even without listening from Rasulullah, because they have the tools. Let me give you an example. When you recite in the Quran, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّي الْفَلَقِ, you memorize this surah. مِنْ شَرِّ مَا خَلَقَ وَمِنْ شَرِّ غَاسِقٍ إِذَا وَقَبَ. You memorize it, but what's the meaning of بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ? What's the meaning of al-falaq? So if you have a person who is talking Arabic, so he can tell you very easy. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually didn't give the tafsir for each and every single verse in the Quran. He just gave the tafsir for what was unclear to the Sahaba, because they were so pure, they did not need to know most of the words, because they already knew it. Even the generation who came after the companions, they still pure Arab, but they got mixed. They had lots of Christians and Jews entered Islam, and they wanted some explanation. So the Sahaba give tafsir for the generation who came after them, at-tabi'in, or the successors, for only what was unclear to them. So now you have levels. Al-Quran gave some of the tafsir, not the whole Quran. The Prophet Muhammad only explained and gave tafsir for only what was unclear to the companions. Then the companions give the tafsir for what was unclear for the tabi'in who came after the companions. So that is why you will find the tafsir of the Sahaba are not too much. The tafsir, the opinions are not too much, because they already knew They already knew most of it. And it was most of it related to the language itself. So if they have some people were non-Arabs, they just wanted to explain to them some of the verses in the Quran. I just wanted in these minutes, I think we have like a question here. So I don't know what does it mean, the dawn, the fajr? This what do you mean? So let me just share with you some of the names. Oh yeah, yes, he is explaining the meaning of al-falaq, the dawn. Yes, mashallah, yes, exactly. Yes, jazakallahu khairan. Maybe I have forgot the question. Jazakallahu khairan. Yes, exactly. Let me just mention some of the names of the companions of the Prophet Muhammad. And let me tell you clearly, when you get something in the Quran and you got confused, you need to search first if the Quran gives the tafsir for that in any other verses. That's number one. Then if you didn't find in the Quran, move to the second level, which is the Sunnah or the Hadith of Rasulullah. But if you didn't find, then we need to stick with the opinion of the companion. But now, imagine if you have one verse and this verse has two tafsirs. One of them, for one of the companions, like Ibn Abbas, and the other one for Ahmad Ali, the poor servant for Allah. So who should you take? Throw him away. This is the tafsir of the Sahaba. Even for Imam al-Shafi'i, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Ahmad, we are talking about the best generation ever. They saw the Rasulullah. They knew exactly what happened when it comes to the asbab al-nuzul, the reasons of the revelation, the occasions, what happened, the circumstances related to that revelation. They saw that by themselves. That is why, for example, when you have opinion for Uthman ibn Affan, radiallahu anhu, Sayyiduna Uthman ibn Affan, one of the great companions who give the tafsir for some verses of the Quran. We rely, as I told you, for me personally, I rely on the opinion of Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Abbas. For many reasons I have, but just one of them, and the most important, is the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for him, especially about the tafsir of the Quran. He said, Allahumma faqqihu fi al-deen wa'allimhu al-ta'wil. Oh Allah, give him the fiqh of the deen, the right understanding for that religion, and عَلِّمْهُ التَّأْوِيلِ. Oh Allah, give him the knowledge of tafsir. So he gave him special dua for that. That is why he was so eloquent in the tafsir when it comes to know the meaning and how to give the evidence, even from the Quran, from his point of view. If he wanted to give his opinion and he wanted to have an example from the Quran for his opinion, that is something very known when you study more about Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. Like, I will give you example. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. Allah said in the Quran, surely those people who will not judge with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had revealed, they are kafirun. They are disbelievers. So Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Abbas said, that is not the kufr that you know. That does not mean kufr is to leave Islam altogether. That is not ridda. That is not apostasy. It is, that means it is kufr. But kufr less than the other kufr, which is to leave the Islam totally. Kufr means to deny. To deny the verses of the Quran or to neglect like applying the verses of the Quran. So that is his point of view. And most of the scholars now, they take the opinion of Abdullah ibn Abbas in this verse. One of the names too, Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, radiallahu anhu. Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, one of the people who give the tafsir for the Quran. So now you have Sayyiduna Uthman ibn Affan, Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Abbas, Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and who else? Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu anhuma. The son of Sayyiduna Umar ibn Khattab was one of the leaders and one of the great scholars of the tafsir of the Quran. So we should stick with their opinion as they are the best generation ever came after the Sahaba, came after the prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So tafsir of the Quran by the Sahaba, we should rely upon and we should depend on, we should take it, we should learn it, and and by the way, that is not too much. That is not too much. And the Sahaba also give the tafsir of the Quran without being so complicated. No, it was very simple. One word, and it means so and so. Another word means so and so, one statement. So that is not a big issue. You will not find pages after pages. They did not make it so complicated, made it so easy and so simple. So the followers or the tabi'een, the successors, used to come and ask them, Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Abbas, you witnessed that. And you saw that, you attended with Rasulullah. And Rasulullah was amongst you guys. So what's the tafsir of this verse from your point of view, from your way of thinking, because you witnessed the occasions and the situations itself. So what is your point of view? And they used to respond, and that was written as the tafsir of the Sahaba. If we mention that the Sahaba had the advantage of seeing Rasulullah, listening from him, so what about tafsir by at-tabi'een? Tafsir al-Quran by the opinions of the successors who came after the companions. What is their advantage? What is their advantage? And what we try to learn more about some of the names of the great scholars. And inshallah, afterwards, we are going to learn about some of the famous books of the tafsir. Nowadays, mashallah, on the internet, you can find, even on the application, like 20 scholars of tafsir, 20 different books of the tafsir. You have Ibn Kathir, Al-Qurtubi, Al-Tabari, Al-Jalalain, and most As-Sa'di. So you have lots of names of the tafsir. What are the most authentic names? That once I get confused, I need to search for that book, for that particular scholar to know. I need to avoid reading a tafsir for hadith, and by the end of the day, they say to me, it has weak hadith. Or that opinion is not strong enough to work with. So inshallah, we are going to mention, and why I have to choose that book than the other. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I have to stop here, otherwise he will give me fine. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will give me fine. And inshallah, you will forgive me. Jazakallahu khairan. I'm sorry, I know we said lots of information, but this is the nature of this course. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us knowledge And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us in knowledge. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Jazakumullahu khairan. Barakallahu feekum. And I just wanted to make dua, inshallah, before we move to everyone, and especially to our mom Afsari. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give her shifa ya Rabbil Alameen. In this, you know, critical time, I know it is something not easy to handle with, but you know, we try our best, and what in Allah's destiny, Allah knows better. But we should not to give and to give up hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to make dua for her and for everyone is suffering, and for everyone having kind of disease or suffering in hospitals. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them shifa ya Rabbil Alameen. اللهم لك الحمد يا ربنا كما تحب وكما ترضى اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين اللهم اشف كل مريض يتألم اللهم اشف أختنا أفسري وأنزل عليها شفاء من عندك يا رب العالمين اللهم أنعم عليها بنعمة الشفاء اللهم أنعم عليها بنعمة الشفاء اللهم اشف مرضانا اللهم اشف مرضانا اللهم ارحم كل ميت اللهم ارحم كل ميت اللهم ارزقهم شفاء من عندك يا رب العالمين وانظر إليهم نظرة رضا اللهم انظر إليهم نظرة رضا إنك على كل شيء قدير اللهم لا تدع لنا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا مريضا إلا شفيته ولا ميتا إلا رحمته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا حاجة من حوائج الدنيا والآخرة إلا وقضيتها ويسرتها يا رب العالمين سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين الحمد لله رب العالمين.